So I know that everybody who's been able to get here has just been so blessed. I see y'all smiling and agreeing, and it was just such an incredible time. And you know, we get to the end of the camp and we think, oh, it's almost over. You know, 9 weeks every night, hallelujah. But you know what? We have the grace. God sustains us because he wants to pour into us so that we have more than enough to take the next season on. Amen? And God is going to bring us into the next season in victory. We're going to overcome whatever there is to overcome. We're going to jump the hurdles. We're going to walk the walk. Amen? And we're going to do what God has called us to do in the harvest season that's coming up. Amen? Well, it's just been incredible. This week is going to be awesome. This weekend, of course, is going to be wonderful with our women's conference. But we've got some great things happening. Starting on Monday, Pastor Wetzel will be here, the granddaddy of the Brownsville Revival. You do not want to miss that. He has got the super joy anointing. Amen? And God wants to increase our joy. He wants us to be filled with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Amen? Amen? It's the joy of the Lord that is our strength. And we need that joy that we can overcome in these dark days. It's like the Lord said, these are the present days of darkness. Hallelujah. Is anybody out there shining a big light? Not this little light of mine anymore. Let's shine the strobe light on them. Amen? The fullness of the hope of glory that's on the inside of us. Well, this weekend's going to be awesome. After Pastor Wetzel comes in, I believe we have Barry Miracle showing up on the scene. Hallelujah. Woo! He's going to take us into the countdown of it's over for another year. But it has been just incredible. It's got me can't wait till next summer already. Got to be careful with that, though, because time flies is not kidding. It's got wings, if you haven't noticed. And the Bible says in these days, he shortens the time that the very elect wouldn't be deceived. Amen? Amen? So we can see we're in the shortening of time season. But tonight we're excited. We've got Stacey Campbell here with us still tonight. If you were here the last two nights, we got blessed. Last night, Wesley was with her, well, the first and last night, but he had to leave early this morning and went on back home. We have things to do at home, too. So he left Stacy behind. We're glad that he did. And it was powerful last night. We heard a wonderful testimony of the life-saving power of God. Amen. And how her son Judah was raised up off the bed. He was not going to be a paraplegic. Amen. But he was risen up by God and by the faith of a praying mama. Amen. Them down and dirty prayers. Down and dirty prayers that mamas know how to pray. So we had an amazing time. It was a time of increasing our faith and believing God for the supernatural, believing God for the impossible. Because with God, there's nothing impossible. In him, it is possible. Amen? So let's put our hands together and let's bring Stacy on up.
Yeah, wow. It's been just great to be here. You know, Wesley went home because he thought tonight was a woman's conference. Well, I don't know how he got that information, but anyway, we're glad to see all the women here tonight. Yeah. And all the guys, too. I know the guys always want to come to the women's things. I know they do. They secretly want to sneak in. I don't know if women have the same desire to sneak into the guys' things, but I know they always want to know what's going on because the action always happens where the girls are. Yeah, you know what I mean? But anyway, it's so good to be here. I have a few product that I want to give away. It's our last night here. And you know that song we just sang, Worthy of It All? Well, David Brimer from Pie Hop, who wrote that song, this is the CD, this is the soundtrack to the Compelled by Love CD about the biography of Heidi Baker. It's a documentary on Heidi and Roland Baker and her life. And a great worship leaders from around America have donated their songs so that money can be raised for the poor. And David Brimer, Worthy of It All, sings that song on here. And Julie Meyer, a dear friend of mine from IHOP, sings Paint Your Picture. It's a prophetic song she wrote about Heidi. I mean, they have like Reinhard Bonnke speaking on here about God is looking for friends with a track. It's a powerful track. I mean, Jason Lee Jones, who's one of the great musicians. So I want to give this to somebody who just loves the poor and will pray for the poor. Okay, when they listen to this, you will pray for the poor. And you're just too excited over here. I have to give that away to you. But there's a bunch of them over there. And there's also the actual DVD, and I encourage you to get that DVD, listen to it, watch it, let your children watch it, bring it to small groups, take it to your church, do a Sunday evening service where you play the DVD, raise money for the poor, maybe in your area, or send it over to Iris Ministries. That's the goal, to help the poor of the earth. And then, as you know, I have a Best of Heather Clark. She's a worship leader from the West. She has amazing songs on here. Anybody know? Any? I've heard of. Okay, there we go. Awesome. And we have also a couple. As you know, Wesley and I wrote two books on praying the Bible. I've prayed the Bible since I was 16 years old. Meditate. This book of the law will not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it. The most powerful form of prayer, to meditate on the law of God. And we've produced a whole bunch of Praying the Bible CDs in order to teach people to pray. And over there on that, you will find Mike Bickle with Apostolic Prayers. Mike Bickle, you know, who started a 24-hour house of prayer, gone for 15 years, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And Bride's Anthem, him praying the book of Revelation. This is Heather Clark singing the Song of Solomon verbatim. It's not every single verse. We need a man. That man in the back there, come on. Singing the Song of Solomon verbatim. And it's, my brother produced it. It's probably her best CD she's ever done. It's verbatim the Song of Solomon, selected scriptures. And it's real jazzy. So you got to like jazz music. It's sort of Nora Jones-ish, you know. And then this is Prophetic Intercession. Joanne McFadder, who was also years with Mike Bickle. Temple Dance, you know, doing prophetic music. Now, I want to give this CD will make you prophesy. You will just get up and you will go. Yeah. Okay. And then we have some testimonies, powerful encounters in the God's realm. You can get this. Like, if you want your faith to be encouraged about real live prophetic experiences happening in this generation, as I said last night, you read the test, you hear the testimony, you see God working in a life, then you know He can do it again. And so I've got a chapter in here. Darren Wilson, who produced Finger of God and Father of Lights and all that, has a chapter in here. Sammy Robinson, Julie Meyer, Patricia King, Joshua Mills, and I'm going to give it to that lady right there. Are you Filipina? No? What national? Peru. Oh, awesome. Great to have you. Yeah. So anyway, that's that. Oh, wow. We had such an awesome day. You'll never guess where I was today. I spent the day at Catch the Fire Church in Toronto. And there were people there from all over North America, Catholics and Protestants, bishops, Anglicans, etc., etc., discussing what it means, what Jesus was praying for, you know, in John 17. Matteo Calisi has an order that's been, he just met Pope Francis this week, spent an hour or two with him, and just talking about, what God is doing on the earth today. And he told us many things that are the radical things that Pope Francis is doing. And how he's saying that you don't, like, especially in the Latin American world, he's rocking the Latin American world, because there were documents written that unless you went to the Catholic Church, you wouldn't go to heaven. You weren't a Christian. And Pope Francis says, no, it does not matter what church you go to. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. There's one mediator between man and God, the man Christ Jesus. I mean, he's just in every way absolutely radical. And I was telling them the story of how I met Pope Francis before he was Pope. Did I tell you that story? In 2007, I was in Argentina. I actually, I'm the international call director, so we were, doing these meetings, and And I'd gone to the Vatican to these conversations with Catholics with Jill Austin, you know, a few years before that. And I met this man named Matteo Calisi, who was in Toronto today at Catch the Fire. John Arnott was there, and many people from around America. And he, we had prophesied over him, Jill Austin and I still remember it, you know, right in Vatican Square, we're prophesying over him and this other guy, this Pentecostal pastor from Italy, who the Pope was just with in Italy. Anyway, so long story short, he was saying, you know, I do the international calls, so I was pulling Brazilian leaders in the body of Christ together to do a day of prayer. And so we were coming from many different streams of the Protestant church and doing a national day of prayer for Brazil. And this brother, Mateo, asked me, he said, you know, would you introduce me to some Protestant leaders, because we want to just have a conversation with them. We want to start reaching out to them, et cetera, et cetera. And so I phoned the Brazilian leaders. I have this in case anybody falls asleep. I don't know why I got this off. I'm making this story too long. So anyway, he said, you know, would you introduce me to some Brazilian leaders? Because I was pulling Brazilian Protestant leaders together to do a national day of prayer in Brazil. And so I went to the Brazilian leaders and I talked to them, and they said to me, Stacey, if you do that, if you pull Brazilian leaders together, you're going to ruin your whole ministry in Brazil. And then I was afraid. So I went to pray. I said, God, like, what do you want me to do? You know, should I do it? Should I try to introduce some Brazilian Protestant leaders? Like, you know, I'm talking like very, very significant leaders over with churches of tens of thousands, and, you know, movements of, you know, 100,000 people in Brazil, just, you know, just like significant leaders. And I said, Lord, should I do it? What do you want me to do? And, you know, I could ruin my whole ministry in Brazil, they say. And the Lord really clearly spoke to me, and he said, Stacey, you don't have a ministry in Brazil. I went, good point, you know. Good point. You know, I was like, well, yeah, that's right. I got nothing to lose. So I did it anyway. And then because of that, he invited me to this stadium event that they were doing in Argentina. And in Argentina, they'd met several times, and they had a small stadium event, about 7,000 people there. We had about 11,000 people at the Call Brazil, and we had like leaders from all across Brazil. It was very incredible, and he came and prayed, and he invited me to Argentina. And when I got to Argentina, it was all about John 17, so they had different denominational heads speaking on John 17 from the pulpit. So they had a Pentecostal prophet guy there, they had a Baptist pastor there, and then they had a guy that they introduced as the Archbishop of Buenos Aires. And so he begins to speak, and so the other two had already spoken, and he begins to speak, and all he did was open his Bible to Philippians chapter 2. And he begins to read Philippians chapter 2, and you all know Philippians chapter 2, that though Jesus thought equality with God nothing to be grasped, he humbled himself and took upon himself the form of a servant, becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. So, and he's reading that text of Scripture out, and suddenly I really had one of my top spiritual experiences of my life. And I begin weeping. All he's doing is reading the Bible out loud. And I begin weeping, and it was as though, like a mount of transfiguration, the heavens of the roof of the stadium opened, and I heard the voice of God, and the whole stadium lit up into this like bright glory. And the voice of the Lord comes to me and says this: these are not just words on a page to that man. This is his whole life. And I was so impacted. I'm weeping like nobody else is weeping, but I'm like, you know, and God's really speaking to me. And so I looked at the Catholic guy that had brought me there, and I said to him, can he pray for me? Like, I don't think you can actually get humility by impartation, but I thought maybe a grace to even pursue it. So I wanted him to kind of lay hands and pray for me that I could, you know, even get a, you know, desire to be like that, you know? And the Italian guy that brought me there, Matteo, he was just learning English, and so he thought I said, can I pray for him?
And so he's taking me up there, and I think I'm going up to get up, you know, to get prayer and impartation. And he thinks I'm going up to give prayer and prophecy, you know. And so it was one of those awkward moments. We stand there, and he says, and then he goes, she's going to pray for you. And I go, ah. And so I just laid hands on his shoulder. I, you know, what do I know? I laid hands on his shoulder, and the Holy Spirit comes on me. And I just repeated what the Lord had just said to me, that those were not just words on a page to him, but that was his whole life. And then out of my mouth, I find myself saying, and because you have so humbled yourself, because you all know the rest of that verse, therefore God has highly exalted him and given him the name above, that's Jesus. And so, and the Lord begins to speak to me and says, because you've so humbled yourself, God is going to highly exalt you and give you the highest place in the Catholic Church, and you will be the next Pope, you know. And so, and when I said it, it just felt like so boing, like that was the Lord. And the next day I was filled with prophet's remorse. Have you ever had that? You know, like, why do you say such stupid things? You don't even know what you're talking about. And all these important people heard you, and you, like, I was like, oh no. And that was 2007. And that was, you know, they introduced him as Father Jorge Bergoglio, something. I can't even pronounce his name to this day. Pope Francis. Now, anyway, but do you know how, like, what had to come together to make that prophecy come true? That Pope Benedict was the second pope in all of church history to resign. There hasn't been a pope resign for 600 years. Had Pope Benedict not resigned, Pope Francis would have been too old to become pope because they have a cutoff point of age. But because Benedict resigned, you know, they all, the whole story, they do the vote, the white smoke comes out. And when the white smoke comes out, like I am, this is 2012. So 2007, I have this prophecy. 2012, they say, Benedict resigned. It's all over the news. And I'm remembering my prophecy. I'm not telling anybody. You know, I'm thinking, why do you say such stupid things? And I'm looking on CNN, and I'm reading CBC, and I'm reading, and like, he wasn't even in the top 25. He wasn't in the top 10, and maybe in the, you know, 25th or 27th or something. He was so far behind. I'm thinking, oh my goodness, like, and everybody heard me, and like, I'm so embarrassed. Suddenly the white smoke comes up, and they announce that it was him, the Archbishop of Buenos Aires. It was Cardinal Bergoglio. Yeah. And he's now the Pope. But I will say this about that, and I'm not ashamed to say it. You know, I became a Christian in a very radical, fundamentalist, cessationist church, and we didn't like anybody. But they gave me the Word of God, and they taught me to love the Word of God. And I do not believe that love and truth are mutually exclusive. I believe that all truth leads to deeper love. And that, you know, that God is going to, you know, that God still so loves the world, and that Jesus' prayer is going to be answered on this earth. And I was recently, you know, with Lou Engel and his little group in Mott Auditorium, probably a couple of years ago now. And I was, you know, there was a tiny little group of us, maybe 35 in this great big stadium. And, you know, in the glory days when I was there in the 90s, you know, it was filled with 200 people rapidly praising God, and now we have this tiny little prayer group, you know, in there, mostly young people. And the pianist begins to play just like tonight, you know, all this prophetic song. I love this prophetic flow. And begins to play and just begins to sing, and he starts going, ask me for the big things, you know, and he says it, you know, and then suddenly he says it again. Ask me for the big things. And it felt like, you know, that it just kind of got lost. He said it a couple times, but the moment he said it, you know, when you hear those prophetic words, that suddenly, boing, your whole spirit goes, ah! It doesn't matter how loud it is, how quiet it is, something inside of you goes off. And when he said, ask me for the big things, it seemed to go over everybody's head, but I was just energized by the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit came on me and began to prophesy, ask me, just go ahead and ask me, just go ahead and ask me for the big things. Begin to ask me for the very things that I am asking for. Begin to pray not the prayers of man, but the prayers of God. Ask me for the nations, for my son's inheritance. Just go ahead and ask me. I mean, it was powerful. Ask me that my church would be one as the Father and the Son are one. Ask me and just ask me for those big things. I mean, it was like my whole spirit was like, and I was prophesying away. And, I was just absolutely catapulted into a realization that God has said to us, and each and every one of you say, God has said to me, that he is going to do exceedingly abundantly above everything we can ask or think. Tonight, she prophesied, the favor of God is on every single one of you. Say, the favor of God is on me. It is on me. You know, God has given me his glory. I mean, that's John 17. But, and it's a powerful, powerful day. And when the church begins to actually believe what God says about us, we will be an unstoppable force. We will not, the 1,000 may fall at our right hand and 10,000 at our left, but it will not come near us. We are going ahead. We are advancing. We are the head and not the tail. We are going to be blessed that we might be a blessing to many. Just like this sister here, we are going to, love God with full abandonment. All of creation is groaning for the manifestation of the sons of God. And I don't care if they had a heresy before, it's still in the Holy Bible and it's still going to actually happen. Come on. Yeah. And so, I feel like God is such a dreaming God. The things begin out of dreams. I mean, cultural changes begin out of dreams. Remember Martin Luther King Jr. I have a dream. I have a dream that, that black and white, they're going to live together. Blah, blah, blah. And in his lifetime, which was in our lifetime, some of us were alive when Martin Luther gave that speech, and now there is a black man that is the president of the United States of America. We got a dream. We got to dream the dreams of God, I'm not talking about a political party. I'm talking about an overcoming of something that was deep in division that was overcome in America. Dreams are the things that keep us going, keep us hopeful that things can change. Dreams, we got to start asking God for big things, like the ending of abortion. In Canada, not one Canadian baby ever aborted in a Canadian soil again. Come on. We got to start asking God. We got to be that little widow just banging away and saying, God, we know this is your will, and we're not going to stop asking this for your will. And we know that if we ask anything, that we have the petition that we desire of you. 1 John something, 5, I think. Well, you can look it up. I want you to learn to just love the Word of God. Seek, search it out, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that doesn't need to be ashamed. And dreams are the things that keep us going in times of difficulties and trials. We can dream big things like like what Martin Luther King dreamed for the ending of slavery and saw it in his lifetime. I mean, not him. He saw that long. That was long before. But I mean, William Wilberforce. But for justice and equality and things like that, I have a dream where we can, or most of us, we can dream for little things. We have tiny little itsy bitsy dreams, like a clean house. That's a nightmare. When I think I have a dream, I remember, saying this, I have a dream. I have a dream that one day I will rise and I will say, children, it is time to clean your room. I have 5 children. And every child, 4 sons, I have 4 sons and 1 daughter, would, jump up from the computer, instantly leave it, move away from the Xbox, you know, get off of the texting cell phone, you know, rush down to their bedroom and actually clean it, you know, not shove the stuff underneath, not take all the clean laundry and put it in the dirty clothes bag. No, no, no. They would sort the dirty from the clean. They would hang up the clean. They would, you know, put the, I mean, I had a dream. And then they would come running back up and say, "Mother, what you have desired is accomplished." Now, I'm still dreaming, man. I'm still dreaming. Because my sons are now 27, 25, 23, and 21, and 19. I don't have any grandchildren yet. But one day I will have grandchildren. And I will have a dream that my grandchildren will come over to my house and say, "Grandma," you know. No, anyway, so I think it's good to have dreams, you know, big dreams, small dreams. I believe that dreaming is divine. God is the ultimate dreamer. God is the penultimate dreamer, you know. That God, that all of creation, everything that we see, the sun, the moon, the stars, the galaxies that are increasing at the rate of something like 1.3 trillion miles per year, the galaxies are actually increasing. You know, the people are being fruitful and multiplying, the trees, they have capacity within themselves to reproduce after their own kind, that there's an increasing, ever-increasing great dream inside the heart of God, that God had a dream, and that everything that we see is a result of the fact that God had a dream, that he would create, you know, he, the perfect God, absolutely complete in and of himself, long before anything was ever created, absolutely complete and whole, lacking nothing inside of himself, had a dream that he would create a people in his own image, and he would give them everything, and he would give them even free will. And he had a dream that, you know, that they would love him. And God kept this dream through the fall. God kept this dream through the flood. God kept this dream through all the idolatries and adulteries of his people. God kept this dream, you know, even through so hit so deep inside his heart that one day he sent his own son, and his own son, you know, gave himself for our sins, and not for our sins only. Hung on that tree was the propitiation, not for our sins only, but for the sins of the whole world, and descended into hell and ascended into heaven, because God had a dream that one day that people made in his image would become his wife. Revelation says that the wife of the Lamb, the bride has made herself ready, and it goes on to describe the wife of the Lamb. What a dreamer. God's such a dreamer. He never stops dreaming. He doesn't even get disillusioned or discouraged. Well, a couple times he did. Maybe the flood, he got a little discouraged. You know, it grieved him in his heart. But he can resurrect that dream and never, ever stop dreaming it. God is a dreamer. You know, no matter, God never gives up on that dream. Never, never, never. And because God is a dreamer, he gives dreams to his people to believe for the highest, the best, the impossible, you know, the exceeding, the abundantly. God dreams things that are so big and articulates them in his word, and causes us to rise into heights of believing for things about us even that are impossible. Over and over and over again throughout the scriptures, God gives dreams to his people. He gave Abraham a vision, you know, and Abraham set off. Hebrews 11 says, not even knowing where he was going, following a dream in the heart of God that a people would be created for his own possession. He gave Joseph dreams. He gave Daniel dreams, you know. And even if your brothers hate you because of your dreams, there are some of you in this room with dreams from God himself that you don't even know how they're going to happen. They're like so crazy big, but they come from God. And I'm telling you, the big ones, those are really him. The great, great big ones, ask him for the big things. I had another prophetic word one time. Was, don't shrink me. Don't shrink me. Don't shrink me to the level of your money. Don't shrink me to the level of your ability. I am God. You know, I mean... I learn a lot about God from prophecy. You know, yeah, okay, bigger, bigger, big God, big God. You know what I, and God has birthed and created every single person in this room. God has a dream for each of you. God has a dream for you. Even if you have no dream for yourself, God has a dream for you. How do I know that? Because the Bible says so. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For by grace you are saved through faith. It is a gift of God, so no one can boast. Every single one of us is saved the same way, by grace, through faith, a gift of God, so that no one can boast. But then it goes on to say in Ephesians 2:10, unto good works that God before ordained that you should walk in. God saved you because he had a purpose that are before ordained, before even you were created, that you are going to walk in. And God's dreams for you are massive. They're big, aren't they, sister? Doesn't matter how far down you get. Doesn't matter how the enemy tries to crush you. If you just grab hold of that dream of God by faith and keep believing in big, 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 big God, suddenly you're catapulted into prime ministers and presidents and popes and all kinds of things. And I can just imagine God thinking, oh my goodness, and I think he gets excited. I am going to create a little girl, and she is going to be a twin. I have a twin sister. And she's going to have brown eyes and brown hair, and she's going to dye it blonde. And she has no idea. She's going to be from a tiny little village in Saskatchewan, population 500 people on a farm, you know. Five brothers, twin sister, you know, all the, and, you know, and she has no, and I'm going to take her from that itsy bitsy little tiny town. And when she's 12 years old, I'm going to put a vision in her to be an interpreter for international affairs, travel all over the world from this tiny, tiny, tiny little town. And nobody knows where she got that idea from. You know, and then I'm going to begin to send prophets to her. And they are going to prophesy to her from her fundamentalist background where women don't even preach and they sit in a separate room to pray out loud with the men with doilies on their head. And I'm going to send prophets to her and say, I see you speaking in front of tens and thousands of people. And I'm going to start blowing her mind, you know, concepts that she could never even think of on her own. It can't be her. And all she has to do is believe it. See, therein is the rub. Many of us have prophetic words that we don't believe. But I want to tell you, if you don't have any prophetic words, it doesn't matter. You got a whole Bible. Got the whole thing. It's all yours. Every promise, by these exceeding great and precious promises, we become partakers of his divine nature. Peter says that. First Peter. You know what I mean? They're all that. They're all there for every single person who actually believes it. Because just people live by faith. And it doesn't matter where you come from. You can come, like me, from an alcoholic family. All your brothers and sisters on drugs. Not a single believer either side, you know, except for a traditional background. And you can get gloriously saved and lead the whole family to Jesus and the next generation to Jesus. And doesn't matter what the context is, because the power doesn't come from the outside. It comes from the inside of the Spirit of the living God, whose temple you are. And everywhere you go, that Spirit of God goes with you. And, you know, he just uses you. Just to stretch out your hand, and the power of the living God that you are the temple of just will go through your hands. I mean, this is who God is. We just have to get our, the faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, and meditating on it until we actually believe it. And then when we believe it, I remember when I was, you know, 16 years old, my mother used to look at me and go, because she came to our church once, and the women were, you know, in a separate room and with doilies on our heads, and she thought I was in a cult. She just could not get it. And she said to me one day, she said, Alec, I am more worried about you than all your brothers and sisters who are on drugs. And I could tell she was, you know, because it was a little bizarre when I think of it now, you know, culturally. But you see, God has a dream. And you are part of his dream. He has a dream for a wife, the wife of the Lamb. But more than that, when he created you unto good works that in his mind are so exceedingly abundantly above anything you can ask or think. It's so big. Absolutely everybody in this room is open to it. It's the kingdom of whosoever will. Anybody who actually believes it can partake of it, can go there. We can stare at him. We can behold him until we are changed, transformed into the same image from glory to glory. We can actually move in ever-increasing levels of glory, 2 Corinthians 3:18. And any single believer, it is not for the superstar. It is for the believer. The believer, any single, I know where I come from. She knows where she comes from. In fact, in the kingdom of God, weakness is a strength. Foolishness is wisdom. So if you're weak and foolish, you're perfect. If you feel weak and foolish, you're perfect. For, you know, God has, you know, the foolish things of this world to nullify the things that are. God has chosen. God has chosen the weak things of this world. God has chosen the foolish things of this world. God, over and over and over again, you look at in the Bible where people were before God made them great. I mean, David, classic example. David, classic example. And, you know, when Samuel says the great prophet comes to Jesse's house, and that, you know, do you have any sons? Jesse goes and calls all his sons, and there you have Eliab. You know, it must be Eliab, you know, because he's so handsome and so tall. When he picked, you know, the sons of Jesse, you know, he's going like this, and then finally goes, don't you have any more sons? David, possibly the greatest friend of God in the Old Testament, although Abraham was a friend of God, Daniel was highly esteemed, Moses talked to God face to face as a man talks to his friend, but David was a man after God's own heart. David wasn't even picked by his own father. That should give some of you hope in this room. Maybe your father didn't see what God himself could do. Maybe God saw that, you know, could see the exterior weakness or the exterior foolishness. But God himself says, I have chosen the weak things of this world and the foolish to bring to nothing so that everybody knows that it's me. Not many wise, not many noble according to the flesh. That's what how it starts out, that, you know, that God does it. And all you have to do is just believe. Just people live by faith. And all we have to do is believe and keep on going. I remember, you know, I feel like exhibit A. Like, I know me. I know where I came from. I know my context. I know how I got saved. I know where I got saved. I know all these things. And, you know, I am shocked. I am literally shocked. That's what the Brazilians pronounce it that way. I'm shocked. Where I come from, honestly, I'm going in a couple weeks to Cuba, and the president of the Council of Churches of Cuba has opened the door for us and our small team to go and meet and prophesy over government officials and pray for them and bring reconciliation between, like, all the denominations in Cuba, and I'm going to have lunch with the cardinal. I just, like they set it up for me. I don't know. I do not know how I know me. And I want to say this, you know, that even prophesying, it comes from faith. Like, I like to tell people, like Paul said, I boast in my weaknesses. Many times we hear stories from behind the pulpit of people's great stories, but we don't actually see, like, the layers of weakness behind that great story. And I feel like sometimes we give a wrong impression of what it's really like to be on this side of the pulpit. You know, because I know me. I know where I came from. I could tell you all kinds of things. But I remember even my first time prophesying, because we were Baptists and we didn't know how to do it. And we just had this little prayer group. And suddenly renewal broke out. And we ended up being invited and going all over the world and stuff like that. And I remember, you know, Wesley used to preach. I didn't even preach. My first sermon was in front of 2,000 people in Bournemouth, England, because we didn't believe women could preach in our church at home. So I was invited my first time in Bournemouth, England. And so I just said, yes, I guess so. But I taught two-year-olds in my church. That's what was my job. And I remember the first time Wesley, so we started going or traveling, and Wesley would always preach because he's a great preacher. And then he would ask me to come up and prophesy. And I remember the first time. So Wesley would preach, and I'd sort of give a corporate word like we were giving tonight. And I remember one time I was at this place, and the Lord said, tonight I don't want you to give a corporate word. I want you to prophesy like the Pentecostals. And I instantly knew what he meant. He wanted me to pick people out of the crowd and give them a word. And I'd never done it before. And it was really hard for me because I prophesy. I like to close my eyes and I like to sense and feel, you know. And it felt like I was prophesying long distance and it was hard to feel with all those other people in the room, you know. And I was like, I'll explain it later. But anyway, and I remember, so I said, okay, Lord. And so I said, well, tell me who you want me to pray for. And I'm sitting in the room and I look around and everybody looks the same. Like, there's nobody sticking out. I don't even know what I'm doing, but I'll just by faith and prophesy according to your faith. You know, that's why I pray the Bible a lot, so I can get some faith. And so I was, you know, looking around. Finally, you know, if one person stuck up maybe ever a little tiny bit more than the other, I said, okay, that person, what do you want me to say to that person? So I looked at that person, and I prayed. I closed my eyes and said, God, what do you want to say to him? And he said, and I saw instantly this little picture, not like a vision, big picture, grayscale, faint image. Like, I want to tell you, like, you know what I'm saying? I wanted to tell you what it's really like. It's just really by faith, a grayscale, ever so slight image, you know, of the guy at a computer with all this creativity coming off the computer. And I said, so I write that down. I said, what do you want to say? He says, you know, that God's going to, so I stand up, and then I had a few other people like that. So I stand up, and that night, and I pretend I know what I'm doing. You know, I kind of believe in fake it till you make it. You know what I mean? So I stood up there and I pretended that I had done this every day of my life. This was not that long ago. And I stood up and I said, you know, you, come up here. And because I was sort of making an example, I pulled him up and I said, you, sir, you know, I was praying for you and the Lord showed me a picture of you. And I saw you in front of a computer with all this creativity coming off of the computer and inventing and da, da, da. So does that make any sense to you? And he grabs the microphone in front of hundreds of people and he says, no. And then he said, in fact, I'm completely computer illiterate. So I thought, well, might as well just tell the truth. You know, God loves the truth. So I grabbed the microphone back and I said, well, you know, when you're prophesying, you can be wrong. You know, we're New Testament prophets and has to be judged and you can be wrong. At which point he felt sorry for me. So he grabs the microphone back and he says, but you know, that all that creativity and invention part, he said, I am making an invention. So I grabbed the microphone back and I said, well, you can be half right. You know, I was like, because I didn't know what I was doing, okay? I didn't know what I was doing. But I'm telling you, inside, I was dying the death of 1,000 cats. But because I kind of got stuck, and so then I prayed for him, and I looked at my paper, and everybody's looking at me, and I just kept going through the page of prophesying over people. And honestly, it was a bomb. It was a terrible night, because the very first person I prophesied over, you know, she could do no mighty works there because of the unbelief that she had created. For their first, like, that lady does not know what she's doing. I don't even know if to do so. It was just terrible. And when the pastor drove me home that night, I was so embarrassed. I was like, ah, and I could feel myself going red from my toes up. And I just felt like Stacey, the red-faced prophet, had a very shiny face. And it was kind of silent. The drive home and he drops me off. And I go to the Lord and I just thought, oh God, I'm so sorry. And I'm just like, I'm so sorry, Lord. I really didn't know what I was doing. I was trying my best. And I hear the Spirit of the Lord say, I want you to do it again tomorrow night. That was my first night. Okay, this is my first night. And so I said, God, you know I love you. I'll do it. If you love me, keep my commandments. I'll do it. I've realized that the worst that could happen to me is I look stupid. And the best thing, that behind the scenes, I will have obeyed God. And it will be counted to me as righteousness because I sought to obey even if I failed. And I try to teach my children, you fall off the horse, get right back on it. Do it again. Do you know what I mean? Doesn't matter. You know, that's where, yeah, going gets tough, get going. But I tell you, I got there to the next night. Fortunately, it was in a different town. Mercy, mercy. Thank you. So I get there the next night, but this night, like, you know, I was nervous the first night. The second night, I am my little knees are just a knocking under. I think I was wearing a skirt, and my little knees were just a knocking. And I'm saying, God, and everybody looks the same, and I barely pick out a person. And I get up there, and I said, I'm just going to prophesy over a few people. I hope I am. And you over there. And I'm so nervous. I am so nervous. And I call this person up, and I'm about, from here to the front row away from the person, and I begin to prophesy. And when I start prophesying, it was as though a bolt from heaven came down and hit that person on the head. And it was very dramatic. And they began, as soon as the word of the Lord came forth, they just got hit by the Spirit, and they just went crazy. It was very dramatic, and the whole, I wasn't touching them or anything, and boom, and the whole faith level rose, and everybody's jumping on their feet. They're, Stacey. No, they didn't do that. But my point is this, that I could have quit my very first night. And many times if we've had a failure or a bad experience, then we say, well, we don't do that, we can't do that. And we're more worried about our own reputation than love for Jesus in obeying him. And, it went on and on. And it's, most things that I've ever attempted to do. I remember my first attempts at healing, utter dismal failures for long periods of time. My first attempt at setting up a national prophetic roundtable, I went to, Cindy Jacobs. I was invited to the one in the States with Peter Wagner and all, like Bill Hammond and all these famous prophets. And I was like, and I remember that they looked at me and said, well, who are the prophets of Canada? And this was, 15 years ago. And I went, well, that's a good question. And I didn't know any hardly at the time. And then the Lord said, I want you to set up and begin to call the prophets out. Canada's a prophetic nation. There's many prophets. Begin to call them out. And I remember, so I called these prophets together. And my first attempt at leading a national prophetic roundtable was humiliating. It was humiliating. I called people who were slightly prophetic. Maybe I didn't know anybody that was really, walking at the time that I knew of in the office of the prophet, although there were some, and people would give me names, and I'd call them together, and it was a disaster. Everybody was fighting in competition. I didn't have control of the meeting. It was like, and I was so embarrassed at the end of that. I said, God, I'm never going to do it. He says, yes, I want you to do it again next year. And I'm just like, most things that I've ever tried to do have been way beyond my natural ability, exceedingly above what I can ask or think. Serendipitous moments where you end up at the right place at the right time, doing the thing. And God is testing us on those little things. And if we're faithful in a few things, God will begin to make us faithful over many things. And money is one of the most important keys. How can I give you true spiritual riches, the Bible says, if you are not faithful with unrighteous money? And many people want gifts and power and all those things, and they're not even faithful with natural money. And where our treasure is, there our heart is also. That's what this woman testified tonight. And God is watching. God watches the offerings, little, simple, basic things that we don't know that he's watching, but he is watching because he wants to give us things that really, really matter. But if we can't be faithful with something so basic as money, don't even tithe. And so a lot of times we're missing the dreams of God by very basic, simple little things. But God has a dream. And God has a dream for every single person in here. And there's not one person made in the image of God that God does not want both to be saved, for he's not willing for any to perish, but for all to come to the knowledge of the truth. And when they do, by grace through faith, he has dreams, that of good works that every one of them can walk in. And if God had it his way, you would all be healing the sick, raising the dead. These signs follow those who believe. In my name, they cast out demons. They raise the dead. They heal the sick. Mark 16. This is what real believers do. They advance the kingdom. Like, read the Bible. Look what they do. And look where they start. Those fishermen that can't even talk. That Moses that can't even say anything. That David, his own dad, doesn't pick. That Jeremiah that's but a youth and a manic depressant, wrote Lamentations for heaven's sakes. Look at these people that God picked. And they became some of the greatest people used in the kingdom of God. And there are people in this room tonight that could change Canada, that could stop the sex trade, that could bring the ending of abortion in our lifetime, that could see a justice move arise in this nation of Canada, that could see the knowledge of the glory of God through signs and wonders and transformations and preparing nations and asking Jesus for nations. You know, his arm is not short that it cannot save. His arm is not short that it cannot save Thailand. His arm is not short that it cannot save Canada. His arm is not short that it cannot save India. God has shed his blood, and there is enough power in the blood of Jesus to cleanse everybody from all unrighteousness. Oh, if only we would believe. If only we would believe. And there are people in this room struggling with their own issues, their own fears, their own hidden secret sins, and wondering if God can actually deliver them. He totally, totally, totally can. It does not matter what you do. It does not matter what you have done. You can be a murderer like the Apostle Paul. You could have been a persecutor of the church. You could have been the chief of sinners like the Apostle Paul. And God says, there is enough power. Not only can I deliver you, I can sanctify you. You can actually walk in a victorious, overcoming, holy life. There is power in my spirit. All we have to do is believe. Really, the key to everything is faith. The key to everything. It's the kingdom of whosoever wants to. All we have to do is believe it. But when we don't believe it, Eeyore, I don't know. It's been like this in my family my whole life. You don't know how bad it's been for me. And you know, I mean, trust me, I pray for people in prayer lines. What can I pray for you for? Wah, 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 wah. You know. No, I'm not trying to mock people, because I know people are suffering. There is real suffering. But sometimes we look so long at our suffering and not long enough at Jesus. We're not beholding him. We're not beholding the power of that blood. The "it is finished" power of the blood, the overcoming power of the blood of Jesus Christ, the authority, the all authority in heaven and all authority on the earth has been given to Jesus. We go therefore and we disciple nations with all the authority of heaven and earth backing us up, and nothing is impossible to us who believe. And so that's my exhortation for the night. And I know I'm preaching to the converted here. I know that many of you in this room, but I'd like to ask, you know, Pastor Maeve and Patty and different ones, we're going to come and prophesy some destiny words over you. Now, the way it works with prophecy, New Testament, we prophesy, you know, according to our faith, and it takes us faith every single time. So I want you to be nice to us at the end, you know, and then you have to weigh carefully or judge what has been said. 1 Corinthians 14, let two or three prophets prophesy, let the others. It's manipulation-free prophecy. You know, I can't control your life. You control your life. You can hear the word of the Lord and you can judge it. You can get a word like Paul gave to Agabus. You know, I'm going to bind you. If you go there, you're going to be bound hand and foot. Inference being, because they threw their arms around his neck and kissed him and, you know, cried, you know, that you probably shouldn't go to Rome. And Paul said, everywhere the Spirit bears witness to me that bonds and afflictions await me, and I'm going anywhere. I'm judging that word, and I'm going to take it as courage on the inside. I know what's coming, and I'm going to go anyway. You know, you have full authority to judge your prophetic words, because God gave you a brain, and your spirit will bear witness with his spirit. And when your spirit and God has a will that you're not getting, he will give two or three other people the same word, and you'll start getting it, usually by not two or three, by 20 or 30, or you're as dense as me, by 200 or 300. It just keeps coming and coming and coming till you can't get away from it. Or you'll read the Bible and the verses will jump off the page and, you know, God will begin to speak to you because all God's sheep hear God's voice and your spirit will bear witness. But the thing is, prophecy is to bring the ideas of God that are bigger than our little tiny bitsy minds into the God realm, into the realm of God, because God knows who He is in you. And if you will just believe Him, you can do the works, the very works of God. So I want to have two or three of us come up here. Maybe you know who the people are that prophesy, that have under your authority here. And we're going to just pray for a few of you and release, you know, the spirit of prophecy that gets you into the dreams of God, that God starts unleashing dreams inside of you. God wants you to be, there's good works that are before ordained. God has things for you to do. God has things for you to do. I remember when the Lord spoke to me about not having any more children. I heard the audible voice of God, and He said, Stacey, it's a long story. And He said, I want this to be your last child. And then He said, I have things for you to do. And, you know, I wanted to have 10 children because I believe the Bible and I believe that God is able and I believe that fruitfulness and, you know, is a blessing from God, and that children are a blessing from God, and there's no greater blessing. You know, it's just awesome. And so I wanted to have a whole bunch and I could only have 5. But I would have had at least 7, probably 10. But our, you know, we're not our own. We're bought with a price. You know, therefore we glorify God in our mortal bodies. And Lord, we just want to thank You. And Father, first of all, we just raise Your hands towards them, all You who already prophesy. Lord, we pray. We pray. Lord, we pray like Moses prayed. We wish all God's people were prophets. Lord, we have no competition in the kingdom of God. Lord, we ask that every one of them, Lord, we are like the Apostle Paul prayed. I wish they all spoke in tongues, but even more that every single one prophesied. Lord, we long for a prophetic people that carry Your testimony with them everywhere they go. Lord, that live in the dream and vision and voice of God realm. And Lord, like You did with Moses, we pray that You would take of the spirit of prophecy that You gave us from heaven, and You would take it from us, Lord, and You would transfer it for to these people in this room, like You gave it to the 70 elders of Moses. Lord, what we freely we have received, and freely we give away. Now just raise your hands. Holy Spirit, I am asking You, God, that You would stir the very testimony of Jesus, the spirit of prophecy in this place. Lord, You would give, Lord, we give away what You gave to us, and we ask for sovereign outpourings from heaven. Lord, even this very night, dreams and visions on those who haven't dreamed, angelic visitations, Lord, discerning of spirits, the ability, Lord, their eyes to be opened into the spirit realm, their ears to be open to hear Your voice. Lord, we are asking, Lord, for a prophetic people, that You would pour out Your spirit, Lord, that the power to be a witness inside of them would so increase, Lord, that they would begin just through the power of God, through the word of the Lord, to lead their family members to Jesus, their neighbors to Jesus. We are asking God for increase, increase, increase. Lord, we labor to see this gift multiplied throughout the nation of Canada. Father, we bless them, Lord, more, more, more in Jesus' name. And Father, be it done to them according to their desire. Be it done to them according to their desire, as they seek, as they knock, as they eagerly desire God. Give, give, give freely, freely, freely. Increase in Jesus' name. So we want to ask Elisha, when he was going to prophesy, said, bring me a harpist. We want the harpist, the pianist, to come up here. Maybe they... No, girl, you can sing. You can sing. You can prophesy as you sing. The song of the Lord. Now, what you're going to see here is you're going to see all different kinds of prophecy. In the Bible, they did prophetic mime. You know, Miriam danced with the tambourine. You saw, you saw the song of the Lord come forth. You saw dreams. You saw visions. You're going to see all different kinds of it. And it, you know, there's so much in the category of revelation in the Bible, you know, so much of it. And so what's always good is to have more than one model, so you don't kind of think, well, compare yourself to one. You might not do what I do, but you might do what that person does. You might identify, because say, oh, because we're going to kind of try to show you how it works, because we're creating a model here, because we want you, like with praying for the sick, to leave this room and start prophesying. You know what I mean? Because all God's sheep hear God's voice. It's a very small step to move from hearing God's voice for yourself to hearing God's voice for somebody else with edification, exhortation, comfort. You know, we wish you all spoke in tongues, but even more, that you all prophesied. That's what the New Testament says. You know, this is going to increase and increase and increase in these last days. It's going to be universal. One day, God's going to pour it out on all flesh. And old men are going to dream dreams. Young men are going to have visions. Men and women are going to prophesy. This is unstoppable. It's unstoppable. So, Lord, we just... Yeah, come on. I like that. You got a good gift of encouragement there, sir. Yeah. So who wants to start? Shabbat Kriya. Okay, good. We're going to take turns.
What's your name here? And the purple? Iceton. Are you guys friends? Brothers? Friends, I hear the Lord saying that he's giving you a revival anointing, and he's giving you eyes to see. He's opening up your eyes, and you're going to begin to even have that gift of knowledge stirred within you. And as you see one, you're going to know that there's an illness, that there's a pain. And the Lord says, begin to step out on that. Begin to say, do you have this? Do you have that? And the Lord says, even as you take your hands out and you stretch your faith out and step out on it, he says, you're going to see healings. He says, you're going to see revival. He says, you're going to see even a spreading of that faith. So the Lord says, step out, because surely I've called you to be a minister of healing, says the Lord.
Amen. 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 Now, have you ever had that experience? Have you ever had that experience where you walk in and suddenly, you know, you'll be feeling fine out there, but suddenly you'll get a pain here, or a headache, or, you know, have you ever had that experience of a word of knowledge for healing by feeling, you know, the word of the Lord for that? Have you ever had that yet? Not yet? Not yet. Okay, now, what you have to do is start to listen for that. So, you know, if suddenly you're just walking along and so you get a sharp pain somewhere, say, okay, God, is that me? Like, did I, you know, is that something? Or do you want me to pray for somebody there? Because you might find a sharp pain, or you might find a dull ache, or you might... You actually do get that, and you don't know where it comes from. That's a word of knowledge for healing. You will begin to feel in your body, you know, sicknesses, and then God said there will be a healing anointing that goes with that. So when you see that, say, is there anybody here? Like, I just got a sharp pain in my elbow. Is there somebody here that has that? And if they say, yeah, that's me, say, well, can I pray for you? And I feel like God wants to heal that in you. And so move it into praying for the sick, okay? So that's awesome. And you're going to do that. You're going to see a lot of sick. Are you... studying right now? Huh? Are you studying at any school or anything? Okay, are you studying in any kind of medical field? Okay, can you stand up here? Are you studying in any sciences or?
I'm in high school.
Oh, you're in high school. Okay, what do you want to be?
Engineer.
An engineer. Okay, I see that. Engineer science quest. But I feel that there is an anointing on you for healing. I feel like there's an anointing on you, you know, for sciences. You know, and I see God beginning to direct your steps in the whole science realm, that you're going to have a gift from heaven to understand sciences and how they work. And I feel like it's going to transfer over even into the medical field, and God's going to give you this gift of healing to accompany what you're already studying in the science realm, and God's going to send you to the people that are stuck in their head to use you for demonstrations of the spirit and power, because they won't become convinced with, you know, just an argument. I feel they're going to need a demonstration of the spirit and power. So, Lord, we ask. Lord, we pray for the healing impartation. And, God, when he senses you in his body, Lord, this thing for healing, God, give him faith to just reach out and pray for someone and see them healed by the power of your name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah. Yeah. Just saw him studying. I saw those sciences on his brain. Okay, go.
Sharon, I just saw you in the kitchen and I saw you stirring a big pot. And when I looked in the pot, it was alphabet soup. And I heard the Lord say that something supernatural is coming out of the natural place. Mm. That God is drawing your heart into a deeper season of hearing His voice. And He said, you're going to hear it in such clarity. He said, you're going to begin to give out a word like you're giving out a bowl of alphabet soup. And the Lord says that the words are going to come forward in that same place of word of knowledge. The Lord said He's put a strong discernment of spirit on the inside of you. And the Lord says, you know my voice and you hear my voice. But the Lord says, I'm going to let you hear it even more clearly in this season, because you've allowed fear to come and you've allowed fear to keep you from stepping out in faith. And the Lord says, I've given you the spirit of faith, not the spirit of fear. And now is your time to rise up and step in. For the Lord says, I've called forth the voice of the prophet even in your heart. And the Lord says, I am calling on you now to rise up in this season and begin to dish up the alphabet soup over my people. Begin to bring them a word in season, a word that brings them forth into the new, says the Lord. For you shall break them through into the new as you rise up and you speak the words that I've placed on your heart. For the Lord says, there will be a miracle in your mouth for many. And as you are faithful to rise up and speak it out, says the Lord, they'll come into a place of faith out of doubt, and you will see great things in the season ahead. Mm-hmm. The Lord says, don't be in fear, my daughter. Mm-hmm. Rise up in faith, for you've got the goodie, because you've got me, says the Lord.
Amen. I want to pray for these two brothers here. Could you both stand up? You know, when she said prayed for those two, I felt like the Lord then wanted to pray for you two. And I feel like this is even sometimes there's signs that God is, you know, when Jesus sent them out, He sent them out two by two, you know, and He used, and one could put 1,000 to flight, two could send legions fleeing. So I feel like that there is an anointing in the two of you that you can go higher together than you could alone, that God is bringing you with a band of brothers. I see a band of brothers, and God is bringing you together. And I feel like the Lord says in the area of the supernatural, particularly with finances, I'm seeing God, Malachi 4, see if I will not open the heavens and pour out a blessing. And I see God using the two of you to contend in faith in the financial realm for the kingdom of God. That there are big things that you need to believe for, not little things, big things like land, buildings, etc., etc. And God has been testing you. God has been training you with little things like, you know, today your daily bread, and, you know, just a plane ticket, and just a this, and just a that. God's been training you in the little things, because He's got big things planned for you, that He wants you to take land, He wants you to take buildings, He wants property, He wants to assign it to you so that you can be a blessing to many. I see people coming in even from other areas and other countries, and there is a community that God is starting with amongst you that is going to be blessed because you are there. But I see know each other? Do you know each other? Okay, I see you praying together, and I feel like that this is a sign of you praying together and starting to ask God for things. And when God gives you visions, there is a supernatural dimension to you. You understand the realm of the supernatural. You already know power. You already pray for the sick. You already do. There is a supernatural realm, but there is a provision realm that is yet untapped to the degree that God wants to give it to you. And I see you like walking around land, everywhere the sole of your foot treads, God giving it to you, God giving you vision for specific buildings and properties for, you know, the community of faith that you're doing. And God wants to just say, start prophesying to that land. Start prophesying. Start setting that apart. Start saying, this land is for the Lord. We consecrate this place for the Lord. This is going to be for the purposes of God in this area. And God's going to really use you. And I see it going to be in a light in the darkness. Like He's taking you into a territory that is the enemy is trying to overrun. And you say, God, why are you sending us there? But God says, I want that territory back. The kingdom of God has suffered violence, and the holy violent are going to take that back by force for the kingdom of God, for Jesus. And there is a power that God is going to give you to get land, buildings, provision, finances, everything that you need to advance the kingdom of God. So, Lord, we bless them. We ask for, we thank you that you've been training them in the realm of power. You've been training them in the realm of faith, but the Lord says, believe me for even bigger things. Amen.
This lady right here in the white, would you stand up? I heard the Lord say that tonight was for you, that you have dreams in your heart. And everything the minister was speaking about tonight has been sending off fireworks in your life. And I saw you hit the floor, and I saw you hit the floor on your knees, and you began to intercede. And the Lord says, don't stop. He says, pray. He says, don't you know I'm bringing those divine connections, those golden connections? He says, in a moment, in a twinkling of the eye, he says, I'm going to shift things around for you. I'm going to turn them around. He says, your dreams are my dreams. I've placed them in your heart, and you shall see the fruition of them, says the Lord.
Hi, what's your name? Yeah, Melanie, can you stand up?
Thank you, Michael.
As I was looking over, I saw a ring, a big ring right over your head, and there was a beautiful big diamond, and I saw the Lord begin to polish and shine it and shine it, and the Lord says that he's shining out all the flaws, and then I see the diamond begin to sparkle. And just sparkle. And the Lord says, even within that sparkle, there's treasure. The Lord says that he wants you to know that you are his treasure. And don't ever think that those flaws are going to keep you below. The Lord says he's bringing you to a new level. And you're going to shine. And that light, he said that light is going to be like a laser light. I see just going out towards your family. And the Lord says that that light is going to just be like a new creation that they're going to see in you. And it's going to draw them. You're going to be like an evangelism. Is that the word? And you're going to just speak life into your family, says the Lord.
Bernard, I instantly saw question marks over your head. And I heard the Lord say, there's many questions still in your mind, but he has given you the answers. And he said, just seek a little harder, push in a little more. He said, they're all there, the answers that you are seeking. He said, some of them you haven't wanted to see. He said, but I'm giving you new glasses. And you're going to see in this next season that you are going to be able to understand things that have been huge questions in your life. I see you stepping up to the bat, and I see you with a microphone in your hand. And he said, he's going to give you an audience. He said, because the questions that are in your mind are questions that have been in many, many other people's minds as well. And he says, he's giving you the answers so that you can pass it on to them. I see you at the bat, and I see you hitting a home run. He said, there's many that are going to come in because you're going to speak the word.
Yeah. Shasta, could you stand up, please? You were standing at the back, and the Lord highlighted you to me right away. And I heard him say, it's a new day, but it's a new lease on life. And the Lord said that this is all new to you, but it's even going to get newer. The Lord says that you have been faithful, and it is your obedience that is opening the door. And I just see one door after another door after another door after another door opening for you. And the Lord would say, my daughter, know that your faithfulness, even in the small things, has brought great joy to my heart. And the Lord says that new life is coming from within you, new in every way. The Lord says that you have allowed him to speak to your heart. You have allowed him to soften even those hard places, and you have been fertile soil to even allow him to come and to speak to you in odd situations, and even situations that you would normally shut the door to. You've been willing to talk, you've been willing to listen, you've been willing to step out. And the Lord wants you to know that you are going to be a very successful and mighty woman in the natural and in the spirit. The Lord says your whole life you've been shut down and people have never expected much from you. But the Lord says to whom much is given, much is required. And the Lord says that I am downloading even into you this day new seeds of destiny and new seeds of life, says the Lord. And you are going to rise up, and even the people that you know will not recognize you anymore. And they'll say, who is this woman? And you will say, I am the daughter of the Most High King. I am the daughter of the Most High King. And I see you with a boldness. You are proclaiming those words. And that testimony of Jesus, that spirit of prophecy, will bring life to people who don't know Jesus. And they're going to say, I don't know who this Jesus is, but whoever he is, I want him. Because if he could do it to you, then I want him to do it to me. And the Lord says that you have a powerful gift of evangelism. You have a powerful, gentle touch that people are going to be able to listen to you and hear your stories and understand hard truths and hard things And the Lord says that I've called you to speak to many hearts and many lives. And I see men and I see women and I see children and I even see family situations that the Lord is going to bring you to sort through and to sort out even the crooked places. I hear him saying, tell her I'm making the crooked places straight. I'm making the crooked places straight, says the Lord.
I'm not sure about this, but I'm hearing the name Sandy, and I feel, is there a Sandy? This is the thing that I'm hearing about Sandy. Sandy that doesn't come from a Christian home. I got the words plucked like a brand from the burning, which was about John Wesley, and he was actually saved and separated, you know, through a crisis. Does anybody know a Sandy that's not from a Christian home? Okay, I felt like that person is really on the Lord's heart tonight. And I felt like the Lord said that Sandy is not a random name, that God knows that person and that he's going to wipe out generational curses, that this Sandy is going to experience a sovereign, like God is going to so work in that person's life, he's going to wipe out generational curses, and they are going to see a whole new generation of believers come, even from their loins, like Abraham, like your descendants are going to be as numerous as the sands of the sea. So I saw this picture of sand, and I felt like the Lord is changing their generational inheritance. He's shifting it all around, and that he wants them to know that he is breaking off, and where sin has abounded, grace is going to so much more abound, and there's a whole new future, a whole new hope. They're not to look backwards, they're to look upwards, and to see what the Lord is going to do in their future, and their hope, and their generation. So Lord, we bless that person in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay.
Is it Linda here? What's your name? Yes. Angelica, that's right. Well, I heard this Lord say, I'm rolling away your sorrow. I'm lifting your grief. I'm the lifter of your head. Oh, and I'm pouring my oil over you. It's a brand new day, says the Lord.
Amen, Jesus.
Oh, I'm shining my ray of hope and light and truth and freedom. It's a brand new day, my love. I'm showing you the way. The Lord says he's going to begin to lift where there's been doubt and depression and discouragement. The Lord says, I'm bringing my light. I'm bringing my hope. And he says, I'm bringing liberty. And he says, you're going to begin to look out the window and it's like they've been cleaned. He says, you're going to begin to look outside and it's like the sun is shining. And the Lord says, from this day forth, know that I am bringing you out. I am bringing you up. I am bringing you to a place of rejoicing, says the Lord. And he says, I want you to begin to praise, and I want you to begin to praise me, and I want you to begin to activate your faith. And even as you do that, says the Lord, he says, I am taking you to a new place, and it's a brand new day, says the Lord.
Amen. And on that note, we're just going to end with this. I felt like as I was preaching tonight, there are people in this room that God has put dreams in. And the enemy, it's like the sower went out to sow, you know, and after the seed went, the enemy tried to come and steal that dream. When you heard the dream from God, like you might have had a literal dream or heard something, or God put an idea in your heart when you were younger that you were going to do this, and the enemy came to try to steal that dream. You know, and God said, for there anybody here like that tonight, that you had a dream, you felt it was from God, but you kind of gave up on that dream. I want you to stand up right now all over this room. You kind of gave up on it, felt like, I don't know, and became discouraged, and you came overwhelmed. The Lord is going to reignite those dreams tonight.
The Lord says it's not too late. The enemy lied to you. The enemy tried to say that you'll never do that. But the Lord said, "The gift, my gifts, my callings, they're without repentance. I will never take that dream away." And you can start it today, and it's as fresh in my heart today as it was in the day that I created you. And I'm going to reignite dreams. And I feel like the Lord says, you can do it. You can do all things through my Spirit who strengthens you. And God is going to strengthen you to be doers of His dreams. And Lord, we thank you for them right now, Lord. And I feel like the Lord wants you to just say, God, I'm willing. I'm willing. I don't know how. I don't know how it's going to happen, but I'm willing. And I'm going to mix my faith with your dream again. And I'm going to step out. Lord, I'm waiting for you to open the doors, bring the connections. But here I am, Lord, send me. Just begin to talk to the Lord. Say, I'm willing. God, I'm sorry I gave up on that dream. I repented that. I am willing, Lord, and I will believe that I'm going to move towards that. Lord, I thank you that you are going to move things right now in the heavenlies. Lord, you are moving connections right now. Lord, even as these dreams are coming alive, God, you are going to do things. And just like when Daniel began to pray, you know, archangels moved from heaven and principalities of Persia, you know, tried to block them. But there is a dream that God says cannot be stopped, that all things are possible. And Lord, we just ignite those dreams and we say they're not too big. They are not too big. They are not too big for your people. They are not too big for you. And Lord, we just pray, God, that you would open now sovereign doors. Lord, that as they move their step towards it, Lord, they take their little buns and their little fish, as it were, and they bring them to you.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, let that multiplication of heaven happen over the dreams of God in their life. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. That's such an encouraging message, not just for the women in this house, but for all of us here as children of God, you know? He equips those He calls. Amen? We don't have to have it all together. We don't have to have it all right. And we don't have to be perfect. Because God equips us when He calls us. Amen? So this is going to be an awesome weekend. We're going to be here tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. Whatever you do, don't miss stopping by Stacey and Wesley Campbell's resource table on your way out.